Hello everyone, now I am going to explain you the continuation part of embedded system components. As mentioned in the previous section, embedded systems are used in various domains like consumer electronics, home automation, telecommunication, automotive industry, healthcare, control and instrumentation, retail, and banking applications, etc. Within the domain itself, according to the application usage context, they may have different functionalities. Each embedded system is designed to serve the purpose of any one of the combination of the following tasks: data collection or data storage or data representation. Second one, data communication. Third, data processing or signal processing. Fourth one, monitoring. Fifth one, control. Sixth one, application specific user interface. Now we shall study the purpose of embedded systems. Under that, first one we have data collection, storage or representation. Embedded systems designed for the purpose of data collection performs acquisition of data from the external world. Data collection is usually done for storage, analysis, manipulation, and transmission. The term data refers all kinds of informations, namely text, voice, image, video, electrical signals, and any other measurable quantities. Data can be either analog or digital. Embedded systems with analog data capturing techniques collect data directly in the form of analog signals, whereas embedded systems with digital collection mechanism converts the analog signal to corresponding data digital signal using analog to digital converters, and then collects the binary equivalent of analog data. If the data is digital, it can be directly captured without any additional interface by digital embedded system. The collected data may be stored or transmitted, or it may be processed, or it may be deleted instantly after giving a meaningful representation. A digital camera is a typical example of embedded system with data collection, storage, representation of data. Images are captured and the captured image may be stored within the memory of the camera. The captured image can also be presented to the user through a graphic LCD unit. The next we'll learn about data communication. Embedded system communication systems are deployed in applications ranging from complex satellite communication systems to simple home networking systems. As mentioned earlier, the data collected by an embedded terminal may require transferring of the same to some other system located remotely. The transmission is achieved either by a wireless medium or by a wireless medium. Wireless medium was the most common choice in all olden days embedded systems. As technology is changing, wireless medium is becoming the standard for data communication in embedded systems. A wireless medium offers cheaper connectivity solutions and make a communication link free from the wire bundles. Data can either be transmitted by analog means or digital means. Modern industry trends are settling towards digital communication. The data collecting embedded terminal itself can incorporate data communication unit like wireless modules, for example Bluetooth, ZigBee, Wi-Fi, Edge, GPRS, etc. or wireline modules like RS-232, USB, TCP/IP, etc. Network hubs, routers, switches, etc. are typical examples of dedicated data transmission embedded systems. They act as mediators in data communication and provide various features like data security, monitoring, etc. Next, we have data processing. The data can be either voice, image, video, electrical signals, and other measurable quantities, which are collected by embedded systems, may be used for various kinds of data processing. Embedded systems with signal processing functionalities are employed in applications demanding signal processing like speech coding, synthesis, audio-video codec, transmission applications, etc. A digital hearing aid is a typical example of an embedded system employed for data processing. Data hearing aid improves the hearing capacity of hearing impaired person. The next one we have is monitoring. Embedded systems falling under this category are specifically designed for monitoring purpose. Almost all embedded products coming under the medical domain are with monitoring functions only. They are used for determining the state of some variables using input sensors. They cannot impose control over variables. A very good example is the electrocardiogram ECG machine for monitoring the heartbeat of a patient. The machine is intended to do the monitoring of the heartbeat. It cannot impose control over the heartbeat. The sensors used in ECG are different electrodes connected to the patient's body. Some other examples of embedded systems with monitoring function are measuring instruments like digital CRO, digital multimeters, logic analyzers, etc., which are used in control and instrumentation applications. They are used for monitoring the status of some variables like current, voltage, etc. They cannot control the variables in turn. So next we have control. Embedded systems with control functionalities impose control over some variables according to the changes in input variables. A system with control functionality contains both sensors and actuators. Sensors are connected to the input port for capturing the changes in environmental variable or measuring variable. The actuators connected to the output port are controlled according to the changes in input variable to put an impact on the controlling variable to bring the controlled variable to the specified range. Air conditioner system is a best example, which is used in our home to control the room temperature to a specified limit to a typical example for embedded system for control purpose. An air conditioner contains a room temperature sensing element, that is sensor, which may be thermistor and a handheld unit for setting up, that is feeding the desired temperature. The handheld unit may be connected to the central embedded system unit residing inside the air conditioner through a wireless link or through a wired link. The air compressor unit acts as an actuator. The compressor is controlled according to the current room temperature and the desired temperature set up by the end user. Lastly, we have application-specific user interface. In embedded systems, with application-specific user interfaces like buttons, switches, keypad, lights, bells, display units, etc. A mobile phone is an example for embedded system with an application-specific user interface. In mobile phone, the user interface is provided through the keypad, graphic LCD module, system speaker, vibration alert, etc. Next, we will discuss a typical embedded system. So this diagram shows a typical embedded system. A typical embedded system contains a single chip controller which acts as a master brain of the system. So this a single chip is connected with I/O ports and output ports, and it is also supported with other supporting integrated circuits and subsystem. That single chip controller can be a microprocessor, a microcontroller, or FPGA, or DSP, or ASIC, or ASSP. Embedded systems hardware or software are basically designed to regulate a physical variable or manipulate the state of some devices by sending some control signals to the actuators or devices connected to the output ports of the system. In response to the input signal provided by the end users or sensors which are connected to the input ports. Hence, an embedded system can be viewed as a reactive system. The control is achieved by processing the information coming from the sensors and user interfaces and controlling some actuators that regulate the physical variable. Keyboards, push-button switches are examples for common user interface input devices, whereas LEDs, liquid crystal display, piezoelectric buzzers are examples for common user interface output devices for a typical embedded system. It should be noted that it is not necessary that all embedded systems should incorporate these I/O user interface. A typical embedded system which consists of a memory is responsible for holding the control algorithm and other important configuration details. For most of embedded systems, the memory for storing the algorithm or configuration data is of fixed type, which is a kind of ROM and is not available for the end user modifications, which means the memory is protected from unwanted user interaction by implementing some kind of memory protection mechanism. The most common types of memories used in embedded system for control algorithm storage are OTP, PROM, UEEPROM, EEPROM, and Flash. Depending on the control application, the memory size may vary from few bytes to megabytes. Sometimes the system requires temporary memory for performing arithmetic operation or control algorithm execution, and this type of memory is known as working memory. RAM is used in most of the systems as working memory. Various types of RAM like SRAM, DRAM, and NVRAM are used for this purpose. The size of the RAM also varies from a few bytes to kilobytes or sometimes megabytes, depending on the application. In order to establish communication with various subsystems of embedded systems and with the external world, communication interface is essential. The communication interface may be used to achieve onboard or external communication. Onboard, like we use I2C, SPI, UART, parallel bus interface, and for external communication, wireless interfaces like infrared, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi are used. In detail, we'll discuss about each block of typical embedded system. In that, first comes is core of the embedded system. Embedded systems are domain and application specific and are built around a central core. The core of the embedded system falls into any one of the following categories. First one, general purpose and domain specific processors. Second one, application specific integrated circuits, ASICs. Third one, programmable logic devices, PLDs. Fourth one, commercial off the shelf components, COTS. In the first one, general purpose and domain specific processors, it has been again divided into three types: microprocessors, microcontrollers, digital signal processors. If you examine any embedded system, you will find that it is built around any of the core units mentioned above. Almost 80% of the embedded systems are processors or controllers based. The processor may be microprocessor or a microcontroller or a digital signal processor, depending on main, domain, and application. Most of the embedded system in the industrial control and monitoring applications make use of the following commonly available microprocessors or microcontrollers, whereas domains which require signal processing such as speech coding, speech recognition, etc. may use special kind of digital signal processors supplied by manufacturers like analog devices, Texas Instruments, etc. Next, we'll discuss about microprocessor. A microprocessor is a silicon chip representing a central processing unit, CPU, which is capable of performing arithmetic as well as logic operations according to the predefined set of instructions, which is specified to the manufacturer. In general, the CPU contains the arithmetic and logic unit ALU, control unit, and working registers. A microprocessor is dependent unit and it requires the combination of other hardware like memory, timer unit, and interrupt controller for proper functioning. Intel claims the credit for developing the first microprocessor unit, Intel 4004, a 4-bit processor which was released in November 1971. Intel, AMD, Freescale, IBM, TI, Cyrus, Hitachi, NEC, LSI Logic, etc. are the key players in the processor market. Different instruction set and system architecture are available for the design of a microprocessor. Harvard and Von Neumann are the two common system architectures for processor design. reduced instruction set computing, RISC, and complex instruction set computing, CISC, are the two common instruction set architecture available for processor design. Now let us know about difference between general purpose processor and application specific instruction set processor. First we shall learn about general purpose processor. So general purpose processors are mainly designed for general computational task, and for example laptops and desktop contains this general purpose processors. So due to high volume production, the per cost for a chip is very low in general purpose processors, and this general purpose processors contains arithmetic and logic unit and control unit. Application specific instruction set processor with architecture and instruction set which is optimized to specific domain like network processing, automotive, telecom, media applications, digital signal processing, control applications, etc. Some microcontrollers, system on chip, digital signal processors are some of the example for this application specific instruction set processors. So this processors consist of on-chip peripherals demanded by the application requirements program and data memory. Next is microcontrollers. A microcontroller is a highly integrated chip that contains a CPU, scratchpad RAM, special and general purpose register, arrays, on-chip ROM or flash memory for program storage, timer and interrupt control units, and dedicated I/O ports. Texas Instruments TMS-1000 is considered as the world's first microcontroller. Some embedded system applications require only 8-bit controllers, whereas some require superior performance and computational needs demand 16 or 32-bit microcontrollers. The instruction set of a microcontroller can be RISC or CISC. Microcontrollers are designed for either general purpose application requirements or domain specific application requirements. Now let us compare microprocessor with a microcontroller. Microprocessor is capable of performing arithmetic as well as logic operations according to a predefined set of instructions, while microcontroller is a highly integrated chip that contains a CPU, scratchpad RAM, special and general purpose register arrays, on-chip ROM or flash memory for program storage, timer and interrupt control units, and dedicated I/O ports. While microprocessor is a dependent unit, it requires the combination of other chips like timers, program and data memory chips, interrupt controllers for functioning, while microcontroller is a self-contained unit and does not require any of these. The microprocessor is a time general purpose in design and operation, while microcontroller is application oriented or domain specific. Microprocessor does not contain a built-in I/O, while microcontroller contain multiple built-in I/O ports. Microprocessor is targeted for high-end market where performance is important, while microcontroller is targeted for embedded market where performance is not so critical. Microprocessor is limited power saving options compared to microcontroller, while microcontroller includes lot of power saving features. Next, we shall know about digital signal processors. Digital signal processors DSP are powerful special purpose 8, 16 or 32-bit microprocessors designed to meet the computational demands and power constraints of today's embedded audio, video and communicational applications. DSP are 2 to 3 times faster than general purpose microprocessors in signal processing applications. This is because of architectural difference between DSP and general purpose microprocessors. DSPs implement algorithms in hardware which speeds up the execution, whereas general purpose processors implement the algorithm in software, and the speed of execution depends primarily on the clock for the processors. DSP can be viewed as a microchip designed for performing high-speed computational operations like addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. Audio-video signal processing, telecommunication, and multimedia applications are also typical examples. Some of products: SOP calculation, convolution, fast Fourier transform, FFT, discrete Fourier transform, DST, NFT, DFT, etc. are some of the operations performed by digital signal processor. DSP includes following key units. First one, program memory. It is a memory for storing the program required by DSP to process the data. Data memory, it is a working memory for storing temporary variables and data or signal to be processed. Computational engine, it performs the signal processing in accordance with the stored program memory. Computational engine incorporated many specialized arithmetic units and each of them operates simultaneously to increase the execution speed. It is also includes multiple hardware shifters for shifting operands and saves execution time. Next is I/O unit. It acts as an interface between the outside world and DSP. It is responsible for capturing signals to be processed and delivering the processed signals. Next, we shall learn difference between RISC and CISC processors or controllers. RISC stands for Reduced Instruction Set Computing. All RISC processors or controller possesses less number of instructions, typically around 30 to 40 instructions. For example, Atmel AVR microcontroller, which has an instruction set around 32 instructions. So next is CISC stands for Complex Instruction Set Computing. This CISC set is a complex and instructions are high in number. For example, 8051 microcontroller, its instruction set contains 255 instructions. Now we shall tabulate the difference between the RISC and the CISC. RISC is reduced instruction set. CISC is complex instruction set. RISC contains less number of instructions, while CISC contains greater number of instructions. RISC instruction pipelining and increased execution speed, while CISC instruction pipelining feature does not exist. RISC is orthogonal instruction set. Orthogonal means allows each instruction to operate on any register and use any addressing mode, while CISC is non-orthogonal instruction set. CISC operations are performed on registers only. Only memory operations are load and store, while in CISC, operations are performed either on registers or memory depending on instructions. RISC contains large number of registers, while CISC contains general purpose registers are very limited. In RISC, programmer needs to write more code to execute a task since instructions are simpler ones, while CISC instructions are like macros in C language. A programmer can achieve the desired functionality with a single instruction, which in turn provides the effect of using more simpler single instruction in RISC. RISC is a single fixed length instruction, while CISC is a variable length instruction. RISC consists of less silicon usage and pin count, while CISC consists of more silicon usage since more additional decoder logic is required to implement the complex instruction decoding. RISC with Harvard architecture, while CISC can be Harvard or Von Neumann architecture. Next, we shall learn about Harvard versus Von Neumann processor controller architecture. The term Harvard and Von Neumann refers to the processor architecture design. So first we shall learn about Von Neumann architecture. Microprocessors or controllers based on Von Neumann architecture shares a single common bus for fetching both instructions and data. Program instructions and data are stored in a common main memory. Von Neumann architecture based processors or controllers first fetch an instruction and then fetch the data to support the instruction from the code memory. The two separate fetches slows down the controller's operation. Von Neumann architecture is also referred as Princeton architecture since it was developed by the Princeton University. The figure below explains Von Neumann architecture concept, where we can see there is a single shared bus for I/O, CPU and memory. Harvard architecture. microprocessor or controllers based on the Harvard architecture will have separate data bus and instruction bus. This allows data transfer and program fetching to occur simultaneously on both buses. With Harvard architecture, the data memory can be read and written while the program memory is being accessed. These separated data memory and code memory buses allow one instruction to execute while the next instruction is fetched. We call this as prefetching. The prefetch theoretically allows much faster execution than von Neumann architecture. Since some additional hardware logic is required for the generation of control signals for this type of operation, it adds silicon complexity to the system. The figure below shows the Harvard architecture diagram. Now let us tabulate the difference between Harvard architecture and von Neumann architecture. Harvard architecture has separate buses for instruction as well as data fetching, while von Neumann architecture has single common bus for instruction and data fetching. Harvard architecture easier to pipeline, so high performance can be achieved, while von Neumann architecture has low performance as compared to Harvard architecture. Harvard architecture comparatively high cost, von Neumann architecture is cheaper. Harvard architecture has no memory alignment problems, while von Neumann architecture allows self-modifying codes. So Harvard architecture, since data memory and program memory are stored physically in different locations, no changes exist for accidental corruption of program memory. While von Neumann architecture, accidental corruption of program memory may occur if data memory and program memory are stored physically in the same chip. Next, we shall know about the difference between Big Endian versus Little Endian processors or controllers. Endianness specifies the order in which the data is stored in the memory by processor operations in a multi-byte system. Suppose the word length is 2 byte, then data can be stored in memory in two different ways. In that, first type is higher order of data byte at a higher memory and lower order of data byte at location just below the higher memory. The second way we can store is lower order of data byte at a higher memory and higher order of data byte at location just below the higher memory. Next, we shall know about Little Endian. Little Endian means the lower order byte of data is stored in memory at the lowest address and higher order byte at the highest address. The little end comes first. For example, a 4 byte long integer, that is byte 3, byte 2, byte 1 and byte 0, will be stored in the memory as shown below. So in the figure below shows, byte 0 is stored in a lower address and byte 3 is stored in the higher order address. Where Big Endian means the higher order byte of data is stored in memory at the lowest address and lower order byte at the highest address. The big end comes first. For example, a 4 byte long integer byte 3, byte 2, byte 1 and 0 will be stored in the memory as shown below. So byte 3 is stored at lower address in the diagram, byte 0 is stored in the higher address of the diagram. Next, we shall understand load store operation and instruction pipelining. The memory access related operations are performed by special instructions load and store. If the operand is specified as memory location, the content of it is loaded to a register using load instruction. The instruction stores data from a specified register to a specified memory location. The concept of load store architecture is illustrated with the following example. Suppose X, Y and Z are memory locations and we want to add the contents of X and Y and store the result in location Z. Under load store architecture, the same is achieved with four instructions as shown in the figure, which is shown in the next slide. The first instruction load R1, X loads the register R1 with the content of memory location X. The second instruction load R2, Y loads the register R2 with the content of memory location Y. The instruction add R3, R1, R2 adds the content of registers R1 and R2 and stores the result in register R3. The next instruction store R3, Z stores the content of register R3 in memory location Z. The conventional instruction execution by the processor follows the fetch, decode, execute sequence, where the fetch part fetches the instruction from program memory or code memory and decode part decodes the instruction to generate the necessary control signals. The execute stage reads the operands, perform ALU operations and stores the result. In conventional program execution, the fetch and decode operations are performed in sequence. For simplicity, let's consider decode and execution together. During the decode operation, the memory address bus is available, and if it is possible to effectively utilize it for an instruction fetch, the processing speed can be increased. In its simplest form, instruction pipelining refers to the overlapped execution of instructions. Under normal program execution flow, it is meaningful to fetch the next instruction to execute while the decoding and execution of current instruction is in progress. If the current instruction is in progress, is a program control flow transfers instruction like jump or call instruction, there is no meaning in fetching the instruction following the current instruction. In such cases, the instruction fetched is flushed and a new instruction fetch is performed to fetch the instruction. Whenever the current instruction is executing, the program counter will be loaded with the address of next instruction. In case of jump or branch instruction, the new location is known only after the completion of jump or branch instruction. Depending on the stage involved in an instruction, that is fetch, read register and decode execution instruction, assess on an operand in data memory, write back the result to registers, etc., there can be multiple levels of instruction pipelining. Figure below illustrates the concept of instruction pipelining for single stage pipelining. Application specific integrated circuit ASICs. ASIC is a microchip designed to perform a specific or unique application. It is used as a replacement to conventional general purpose logic chips. It integrates several functions into a single chip and thereby reduces the system development cost. Most of the ASICs are proprietary products. As a single chip, ASIC consumes a very small area in the total system and thereby helps in design of smaller systems with high capabilities or functionalities. ASICs can be prefabricated for a special application, or it can be custom fabricated by using the components from a reusable building block library of components for a particular consumer application. ASIC-based systems are profitable only for large volume commercial productions. Fabrication of ASICs requires a non-refundable initial investment for the process technology and configuration expenses. This investment is known as non-recurring engineering charge, NRE, and it is a one-time investment. If NRE is borne by a third party and application-specific integrated circuit, that is ASIC, is made openly available in the market, the ASIC is referred as application-specific standard product, ASSP. The ASSP is marketed to multiple customers just as a general purpose product is, but to a smaller number of customers since it is for a specific application. The ADE7760 energy meter ASIC developed by Analog Devices for energy metering applications is a typical example for ASSP. Programmable logic devices. First, let us understand what is logic devices. Logic devices provide specific functions including device-to-device interfacing, data communication, signal processing, data display,
timing and control operations, and almost every other function as a system must perform. Logic devices can be classified into two broad categories, fixed and programmable. As the name indicates, the circuit in a fixed logic devices are permanent. They perform one function or set of functions. Once manufactured, they cannot be changed. On the other hand, programmable logic devices, PLDs, offers customers a wide range of logic capacities, features, speed, and voltage characteristics, and these devices can be reconfigured to perform any number of functions at any time. With PLDs, designers use inexpensive software tools to quickly develop, simulate, and test their designs. Then, a design can be quickly programmed into a device and immediately tested in a live circuit. There are no NRE costs, and the final design is completed much faster than that of custom fixed logic device. Another key benefit of using PLD is that during the design phase, customers can change the circuitry as often as they want until the design operates to their satisfaction. That's because PLDs are based on rewritable memory technology to change the design. The device is simply reprogrammed. Once the design is final, customers can go into immediate production by simply programming as many PLDs as they need with the final software design file. The two major types of programmable logic devices are field programmable gate arrays, FPGAs, and complex programmable logic devices, CPLDs. Next, let us know the difference between CPLDs and FPGAs. First, let us know what is this FPGAs. Of the two, that is CPLDs and FPGAs, FPGA offer a highest amount of logic density, the most features, and the highest performance. The largest FPGA now shipping part of the Xilinx Vertex line of devices provides 8 million system gates. These advanced devices also offer features such as built-in hardwired processors, substantial amounts of memory, clock management systems, and support for many of the latest very fast device-to-device signaling technologies. FPGAs are used in a wide variety of applications ranging from data processing and storage to instrumentation, telecommunication, and digital signal processing. So next, coming to CPLDs, by contrast, CPLDs offer much smaller amount of logic, up to about 10,000 gates. But CPLDs offer very predictable timing characteristics and therefore ideal for critical control applications. CPLDs such as the Xilinx Cool Runner series also require extremely low amount of power and are very inexpensive, making them ideal for cost-sensitive, battery-operated, portable applications such as mobile phones and digital handheld assistants. Now let us know advantages of PLDs. PLDs offer customer much more flexibility during the design cycle. PLDs do not require long lead times for prototypes or production parts because of PLDs are already on a distributor's shelf and ready for shipment. PLDs do not require customers to pay for large NRE cost and purchase expensive mask sets. PLDs allows customers to order just the number of parts they need when they need them, allowing them to control inventory. PLDs can be reprogrammed even after a piece of equipment is shipped to a customer. Next, let us know about commercial off-the-shelf components, that is COTS. A commercial off-the-shelf product is one which is used as is. The COTS components itself may be developed around a general purpose or domain specific process or an ASIC or a PLDs. The major advantage of using COTS is that they are readily available in the market, are cheap, and a developer can cut down his or her development time to a great extent. The major drawback of using COTS components in embedded design is that the manufacturer of the COTS component may withdraw the product or discontinue the production of the COTS at any time if rapid change in technology occurs. Advantages of COTS: ready to use, easy to integrate, cheap, reduced development time.
Typical examples of COTS hardware unit are remote controlled toy car control units, including the RF circuitry part, high performance, high frequency microwave electronics, high bandwidth analog to digital converter, devices and components for operation at very high temperatures, electro-optic IR imaging arrays, UV IR detectors, etc. The TCP/IP plugin module available from various manufacturers like Wiznet, Freescale, Dynalog, etc. are very good examples of COTS product.